Hey, this is DJ from djstrains on YouTube, and this video is about yards. Now, as an engineer for CSX for the past 20 years, a lot of times I do work the main line in these big heavy coal trains and the long mixed freights and the auto racks, but sometimes I like to work the yard jobs in the locals, and that's where I'm at throughout the summer, and I'm going to talk about the place called Aliquippa that I'm working right now. Aliquippa is located 22 miles northwest of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and was the home of J&L, Jones & Laughlin Steel Mill. This massive complex had some of the largest blast furnaces and steelmaking facilities. It's been torn down. There's pretty much no remnants of steelmaking. The only thing that I can find is the bridge that used to take the trucks of hot slag out of the plant. That is the only thing that shows that there was steelmaking here. Looking at this old track map from whenever the mills were operating, you see that the dark colored lines represent the two main lines and the controlled siding. These are controlled by the dispatcher. Next we have the passing siding and the yard. Now things have been altered just a little bit, but looking at this is facing west towards the Black's Run signal. You'll see the two main lines, the controlled siding and the yard lead. It does allow us to go from the controlled siding to the yard lead with some hand throw crossovers there. The Ohio River's to our right. This is up against a hillside with Route 51. Now looking at the tracks from right to left, we have our number 2 main, number 1 main, and the controlled siding. All three tracks are controlled by the dispatcher, signaled in and out. Anything other than main track is 10 miles per hour. Now next to the controlled siding where we see that long strip of covered hoppers, that and the empty track to its left, those tracks are very long. They are sided, they have switches at both ends. That is leased to Kelowna Transfer, so those are Kelowna A and B. They go all the way down. And then next we have number 2 track. Now we see right there, there's 5 covered hoppers. Number 2 track is probably the shortest track we have in the yard. It just ends. Number 3 also just ends. But 4, 5, 6, and 7 are double ended. Now we're crossing over the bridge that used to take the slag trucks out. This yard has changed periodically throughout the years. To our left, we have some of the maintenance away stuff where they have just some stuff for repairing tracks. All that stuff down in the river, that is private. Now, if you look closely, you'll see where number 2 track just simply ends. Nothing fancy. I don't think I even see a bumper. I think it just simply ends. Number 3 we like to use. It's a longer one. And 4, 5, and 6, since they're double-ended, we do work. When we're switching, let me explain this. When we're switching, this, like I said, this is the east end. We switch from the east end. We build our trains from the east end. Because in the west end, which I showed you earlier, that is controlled by Kelowna. It's just easier for us to switch on the east end and not have to deal with them getting permission. We always like to leave one track open. And in this situation, number 6 track is open for us to do our runaround moves. You're always going to see a lot of these center beam flat cars, and that is for handling drywall or gypsum. And we call these our gyp cars. We have 2 plants that we service, and they keep us really busy. All right, so here you see how number 3 track just ends, and 4, 5, 6, and 7 are connected onto a lead. But look at this old map. Yeah, way different, because you see it looks probably like 5 tracks of an interchange, and then another yard for A and S. Let's show you how it looks now. Okay, so here's that split. Now I left my 2 engines on what is known as the A&S lead. A&S stands for Aliquippa and Southern. And yes, that is a railroad, a little short line railroad, that used to service the J&L steel mill. Now it simply services a cement plant. So I left my two engines on the A and S lead. We're always using four axle units, usually a mother and slug, or two individual GP40s, 40-2s, -3s, whatever we have. Oh, I forgot to mention, this yard, everything up here was once the Pittsburgh and Lake Erie Railroad. I apologize. But now it's CSX. Now that interchange used to be between the P&LE and the A&S. Now it's just two tracks. And to make things simple, we'll just call this East 2 and East 3 so it doesn't get confused with the stub ends on the west end. So East 2 and East 3 are the surviving interchange tracks for running around. And there you see another set of power. We leave the power out. There is no turntable, no roundhouse, no fueling facilities. This is where the fuel trucks pull up and fuel our engines. Okay, so let's go to the left, and we are following the A&S lead to their so well-maintained yard. Now look at this. Let's get a little closer here. If you want to model a nice yard, okay, this is what you model. All nice, perfect right-hand switches, all perfect uniform ballast, perfect walking conditions for conductors, perfectly straight, no flex track needed. This is what you want to model if you want to model that little perfect yard. You could do this with Unitrack. It's just so nice and uniform. Look at that. Perfect. And it is double-sided. So yes, there is a ladder on the other side, and then it goes down towards the cement plant. But very well-maintained yard. All right, my power that day was these two engines. If you wonder why CSX painted the roof white, it was before they got the air conditioners. They figured that it would make it cooler by painting the roof white. It didn't work. So we have our two units here, always using four axles to switch. And another thing I taught you guys is we have to be behind that yellow tie that you find in all yards, anywhere there's a clearance point, so it does not foul the next track. And here you see our old yard office and the Aliquippa signal. It's an intermediate. It controls nothing. So you have the two mainline tracks followed by the controlled siding. And in this situation, we would be shoving east with probably six or seven empty cars. So we're coming down the controlled siding. I'm going to speed things up a little bit. There's a hand throw switch right there, followed by a derail. And the derail, hand throw derail, protects the industry. This is U.S. gypsum. So we shove down this little grade around the curve. Conductor's usually riding, or else he'll take the truck down there and meet me at the road crossing. And we have to prevent against all the truck traffic. Now the industry does have a few tracks. They will give us instructions on where they want the empties spotted and on which tracks our loads are to be picked up. Modeling a JIT plant would be a lot of fun. It's easy to scratch build something small, and it gives you a lot of switching opportunities. Or if you don't want to model the JIT plant, you can model all the yards that used to be there to service the steel mill. Look at that. Man! Old map, but still gives you an idea of how massive those yards were. All right. Well, I hope you enjoyed this video. Subscribe to my channel, DJ's Trains. Click that bell icon to be notified of future videos and follow me on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram. Make sure you model an access road too. Make it real bumpy so crews get whiplash driving back and forth. All right, so I hope you liked this video, got some ideas. Follow me, and I have more videos coming out. Hopefully you learned from a real engineer who's been doing this for 20 years and still plays with model trains. There is something wrong with me. My mom was right. She was right. She said, "There's something wrong with that boy. He's just not."